Welcome to my channel, Remember Me. Firstly, I'd like to thank you so much for taking the time to watch this video and to remember this case. I believe that if people remember, talk about cases, then there'll be more of a chance that new information will surface or that this information could help solve a case. If you would like to recommend a case, please contact me on my details below. In honour of Australian Missing Persons Week, last week, I wanted to look at Tony's story because he played such a significant part in the formation of Missing Persons Week. Just a warning that some viewers may find the content distressing. Anthony John Jones, also known as Tony Jones, was an Australian man who disappeared while backpacking in North Queensland in November 1982 at the age of 20. He disappeared without a trace, and his case was one of Australia's most baffling cold cases. Tony was born on July 3rd, 1962, and if he's still alive, he'd be currently aged 58. Disappearance. The time of his disappearance, Tony Jones, a native of Perth, Western Australia, was in the last stages of a six-month working holiday around Australia. After quick visits to Adelaide, Melbourne, Canberra, and Sydney, he settled for several months in Brisbane before finally setting off on the home leg of the journey with his brother Tim Jones. For 3 weeks, Jones hitchhiked while his brother rode a bicycle. They communicated by phoning relatives and leaving messages for each other. Along the way, they met briefly up at Mackay and Airlie Beach and spent a week together in Townsville, Queensland, where they shared a caravan with two fellow travellers at the Sun City Caravan Park in Rosalie. On the day before he disappeared, an eyewitness saw Tony drinking with an older man in a local hotel. When Tim Jones began the 900-kilometre bike ride out to Mount Isa, Tony Jones set off alone on the 28th of October 1982 for a side trip to Cairns. When he arrived back in Townsville on the 3rd of November 1982, he phoned his family and girlfriend in Perth. He was surprised to learn that Tim Jones had already reached Mount Isa and learnt that his mother had just topped up his bank account with an extra $150 that would be shared between him and Tim Jones. Tony made no more phone calls and did not use his bank account again and never made it to Mount Isa. Criticised investigation. The first attempts of the Jones family to phone in a missing persons report on the 11th November 1982 were complicated by red tape. The investigation by Queensland Police only commenced 3 days later when the family members travelled 5,000 kilometres to file the missing persons report. As stated at the inquest, basic inquiries were neglected. For example, police failed to get a report from the hospital on treatment Jones had received prior to his disappearance, and at least one key witness mentioned by the coroner was never interviewed. The family was also left without police assistance when they conducted a door-to-door inquiry in the vicinity of the phone booth on Bowen Road, Rosalie, which was the last confirmed whereabouts of Tony. Police did not release a composite sketch of a suspect until 10 years after they received information about the suspect. Media reports on the inquest highlighted other problems with the investigation, reporting that some of the witness statements were missing and that the former investigating officer had been uncooperative with coronial inquests. The media also reported that it wasn't until 2001 that statements were obtained from several people who first approached police in 1982. Other criticisms were voiced by the coroner and the coroner's assistant. Coroner Fisher said more attention should have been given to earlier investigation, while his assistant, Sergeant Kim Farquharson Jones, said the inquest evidence showed police the investigations into the disappearance were not sufficient by today's standards. And the Commissioner of Police, Terry Lewis, who held the post during the early years of the Jones investigation, was subsequently convicted and jailed for corruption. Cloncurry search. In January 2011, retired grazier from Cloncurry informed the Jones family of old evidence that appeared to have been lost or forgotten by police over decades. He said that about 29 years earlier, he had given Cloncurry police some physical evidence which he and a friend, a retired police officer, found on the edge of the township. The evidence included remnants of some camping gear and a letter addressed to Jones from his mother. The witness said he was frustrated by the lack of response from police when he made the inquiries in 2010 about the old evidence. However, the family relayed his story to the coroner, and the coroner instructed police to undertake a thorough search for the campsite. On the 11th of October 2011, a search party of 8 officers and 4 SES volunteers spent 6 hours searching the campsite, identified as a 50-meter squared area beside the Conclory River near the intersection of Kwame Road and Barclay Highway. The search failed to find any signs of Jones' belongings or remains. After the search, Northern Region Crime Coordinator, Detective Acting Inspector Mick Walker, told the media that police were still investigating what happened to the evidence handed in to Cloncurry Police 29 years ago. Coronial Inquest. In May 1983, government issued a reward of $20,000 for information which led to the apprehension and conviction of the person or persons responsible for the disappearance and suspected murder of Jones. In 2010, the reward was increased to $250,000. Despite no body having been found, Coroner Ian Fisher stated in his findings on the 20th of February 2002 that Jones was a victim of a homicide. "I am satisfied that the missing person is dead," wrote the coroner. "I find that he died on or around the 3rd of November 1982 at the hands of a person or persons unknown." In spite of the homicide findings, Jones's family were initially unable to get a death certificate because of an anomaly in Queensland's legislation, which prevented the issuance of a death certificate in cases where the coroner failed to indicate a specific place of death. The Attorney General of Queensland and the Minister of Justice, Linda Lavarch, subsequently introduced new legislation in 2005, saying, "The Jones family have suffered enough, they should not suffer further by not being able to get a death certificate for their son." The certificate was eventually issued in January 2006. Reopening the coronial inquest. The Jones family's review of inquest documents in 2007 unearthed a slew of neglected leads. However, owing to the protracted and unsatisfactory response of police and government officials and a refusal by authorities to refer the case to the cold case units, the family petitioned the Attorney General, Cameron Dick, on the 14th of June 2009 to reopen the inquest. The petition was ignored for 14 months. But then in September 2010, Dick announced that he had introduced the state coroner, Michael Barnes, to reopen the inquest. The new inquest had been beset with long delays, a protracted police investigation, and a changeover of key personnel, such as the coroner and counselling assistant. However, on the 14th of April 2016, some 6 years after the family first petitioned, the state coroner, Terry Ryan, had a pre-held inquest hearing, and subsequently scheduled the new inquest to be held in Townsville from the 29th of August until 9th September 2016. Suspects. A witness told police he had seen an older man with Jones at the Rising Sun Hotel in Townsville on the night he disappeared. 10 years later, in 1992, police published an identifying picture of the suspect. The first tip-offs from the public suggested the sketch resembled the former police superintendent, Melvin Henry Stevenson, a former stock squad officer whose retirement as officer in charge of the Townsville Police about a year before Jones disappeared was tainted by accusations of corruption. Stevenson's name surfaced during the original inquest in 2001, but inquest transcripts and the 2009 follow-up police report by case investigator Senior Sergeant John Mahoney indicated that up until that time, 17 years after the tip-off, police had never investigated Stevenson's involvement in the disappearance. In February 2016, during the lead-up to the new inquest, Mahoney confirmed Stevenson was a person of interest and that it is now up to the coroner to decide if Merv will play a part in the inquest. A second sketch was produced by Townsville Bulletin artist Chris Broughton. The sketch yielded several more leads, some of which had not been investigated by the time of the inquest in 2002. The coroner instructed police to continue their investigation of those leads, particularly in relation to two persons of interest called Pickering and Douglas. However, another 7 years elapsed before police acted on the coroner's instructions, and by that time, Pickering and Douglas had both died. A 1999 internal police memo obtained by the Jones family under the Freedom of Information Act 1982 alludes to another suspect with a prior criminal conviction. The case officer wrote the following to the homicide squad. I have also received a letter from a retired grazier who is named a suspect by the name of blank, and I note that his history indicates he is most probably a blank, and I insist that he should be interviewed. I have attached a copy of the letter. However, neither the grazier's letter nor details of any homicide inquiries related to the letter were documented or discussed at the inquest in 2002 or even made known to the family. Andy Albury. Albury was sensationalised by the media as a serial killer and Australia's Hannibal Lecter, as he boasted to killing 14 other people in a spree while he moved from Townsville to Mount Isa between 1970 and 1982. He became a person of interest in the Jones disappearance after he confessed to knowing about the case. Albury was convicted of murdering Gloria Pinnadan in November 1983 and claims to have killed many more. Albury's confession was disregarded as he was proven by experts to be severely mentally disabled, suffering from the schizophrenia among other disorders. It is speculated that Albury was confessing for the glory and the media attention. Rifle. Jones was known to be carrying a dismantled rifle in his backpack at the time of his disappearance, but the rifle was never found. It is a 22 caliber Vorine rifle, serial number 257435, and the stock was stained dark red. In 2015, police began an investigation to find the firearm and released a photo to the public. Those that knew about Jones' rifle, however, were quick to point out that the police released a photo of the wrong rifle, and this was not the Vora 22 caliber bolt action rifle that he had actually belonged to Jones. Police continued this neglectance when they investigated a lead that a rifle, the same as Jones, had been given to a witness by his brother-in-law, who was a key suspect in the investigation. The police showed the witness the photo of the rifle to confirm that they were the same, and the witness didn't recognize the rifle and it subsequently disregarded. The photo that was shown to the witness, however, was the same incorrect photo that was released to the public and was not the rifle that was being investigated. Unsolved leads. In January 1983, police received a tip-off on the whereabouts of Jones' body. The letter was postmarked Cairns, where Jones had visited in the days before his disappearance. The text is as follows. I believe body of AJ Jones buried in or near Fullerton Riverbed within 100 yards south side Flinders Highway, Lochill. After a fruitless two-day search, police concluded the letter was a hoax. Inquest documents revealed that in the weeks before the search, the dry riverbed was flowing with about 200 foot of water and that there was not much hope of finding any trace of Jones or his belongings. The Jones family urged police to use DNA profiling of the Lochill evidence to determine the identity of Lochill. For years, police declined on the grounds the evidence had not been preserved in good condition, but they subsequently admitted to the coroner investigation that they had lost the Lochill letter. Renewed hope of a major breakthrough. On the 8th of February 2014, Mahoney announced that fresh and credible information linking Jones to a country town in northwest Queensland had sparked renewed hope of a major breakthrough. Further updates about the breakthrough were given on the 10th of February 2014 by Townsville Detective Acting Superintendent Cheryl Scanlon, who announced that a team of detectives was heading to Hughenden to speak with people who lived and worked in the town the years Jones disappeared. On the 12th of February, Scanlon said new information had indicated Jones may have been murdered at Hughenden. Huon Den first became a place of interest in December 1982 when at least five people from there alleged that on the weekend of the 12th to the 14th of November, they talked with a young hitchhiker who bore a resemblance to Jones. Police collected statements and made further inquiries around the town. It transcribed that one sighting referred to a young man of Aboriginal descent, another to an Italian tourist. The others were about a man with a full beard. One witness said she had talked with Jones at the Grand Hotel around 8 p.m. on the 12th of November and that he was identical to the photograph of Jones, including what she called the Abraham Lincoln-style beard. The fact that Jones had shaved his beard off a few days before his disappearance, as well as the elapse of time and failure to assess his bank accounts or contact his family or girlfriend in that time, meant that all of the Hunigan sightings were subsequently dismissed by the lead investigator, Detective Chris Lill, and by Coroner Fisher in the 2002 coronial inquest. New confessions. It is possible that Jones was killed and disposed of in an outback slaughterhouse in Huon Den after two ex-partners and one friend bravely revealed that Kevin Wright had confessed to the crime alongside his close friend, John Eastorf. Wright and Eastorf were known around the community for drinking and fighting. At the time, Wright was 17 and worked as an apprentice at his father's butcher's and slaughter's house. Eastorf was a boarder at a local school, but his family lived in Hugenston. In 2011, 3 decades later, three women spoke about Wright's separate confessions to each of them while drunk and hysterical. The ex-partners of Wright claimed that their relationship with the man was violent and he would beat them frequently, causing the women to fear for their lives. Wright would boast that he could have gotten away with murder and became a very different person when he was angry, beating and choking the woman. Seemingly tormented by his dark secret, Wright confessed to the witnesses on separate occasions that Eastorf had punched this hitchhiker and broke his neck. Wright claimed to have picked up the body and put it through the bandsaw at his father's slaughterhouse. Wright's ex-partner went to the police after hearing the confession, but was forced to by Wright to retract her statement. She went to the police station and told them the statement was made up, fearing the lives of her and her daughters if she did not. The three women stayed silent out of fear of the abusive man. Wright was regularly cutting up animals and boiling up the bones in copper pots to dispose of them. Disposing of a body would not have been a difficult task for the pair. The remains were unlikely to have ever been detected after being burnt in pits. The slaughterhouse has been named a location of interest in the frequent inquiry. Whether or not Jones crossed paths with these two men in Hugenston in the matter of a coronial inquest that is still going on. Both men appealed to the Supreme Court to avoid giving evidence, but this appeal was lost by Wright in 2016. At this point, they did not have enough evidence to prosecute the two men. Cold case playing cards. In February 2008, more than 500 decks of cold case playing cards were distributed to inmates at several Queensland prisons in the hope that significant crimes could be solved if prisoners revealed information after being prompted by the cards. Details of Jones can be found on the Two of Spades. Australian Missing Persons Week. As said at the beginning of the video, Jones' disappearance was the inspiration and catalyst for the establishment of the Australian National Missing Persons Week in 1988. The inaugural Missing Persons Week was launched with a memorial service at the Holy Spirit Church in Townsville, after which the city's mayor planted a tree in commemoration of Jones. Missing Persons Week is now held every week in Australia in the first week of August to highlight and remember the plight of missing persons and their families. This year, the message presented for Australian Missing Persons Week is, "I'll see you later." Tony Jones went missing 37 years ago. His mother passed away 10 years after her son's disappearance without knowing what happened to her son, and Tony's father is currently in his mid-90s. Unfortunately, initial investigations to find Tony were clearly corrupted or not carried out properly. Over the years, there have been various leads and attempts to find Tony's remains, but none of them have been successful. Tony was described as a larrikin with a good-natured and gentle soul. His family vowed that they will keep fighting for answers. If you have any information regarding Tony's case, please contact Crime Stoppers on 1-800-333-000. Tony Jones' disappearance remains unsolved. I wanted to thank you so much for watching this video and for taking the time to remember this case. It would really mean a lot if you could share this video to spread these people's stories in the hope that new information will resurface. To recommend a case, please contact me on Instagram or send me an email. Thank you!